You know, about a year ago, I was in Paris, and together we formally launched what I view as a movement, talked about launching home sharing clubs. And today, as I stand here, I can say that the state of the movement is strong, and it's getting stronger. And that's really a tribute to you. You are the heart and soul of what makes us strong. Now, I think it's really important to sort of understand what is going on out there. Our world is changing an awful lot, and the context for this changing world is incredibly important to what this movement is about and what we're doing. There's, in effect, five major trends that are taking place globally, and I just want to tick through them because I do think they really explain an awful lot. The first is the nature of our people is really changing. The millennials, followed by Generation Z, are going to be the biggest generation in global history. These are folks who really value the importance of experience more than anything else. By over 80%, they say that they want to spend their resources on experiences. You think about how this generation sort of moves forward, right? This is going to be the generation that will be the majority of the electorate, the majority of consumers as we go forward. And you can see how their living patterns are changing. Over the last 10 years or so, you've seen this line cross where more and more people are moving from the country and into the cities. And what that really reflects is that this is a generation that does very much care about experiences. They're going to cities so that they can get those types of experiences. The second major trend is our technologies are changing. Everyone knows that. But think about the fact that in your hand, your mobile device now has infinitely more computing power than the rocket, the Apollo 11, that took humankind to the moon. And you project forward as we go over the next 10 years or so. You know, right now, about 40% of the world has access to broadband. About 75% of the world has access to mobile phones. Over the next 10 years or so, the mobile connection will get to 100%, and pretty quickly thereafter, broadband internet connection will get to 100%. And why that's really important is that for the first time in human history, everyone will be connected to one another. Think about how the car liberated the baby boomer generation, allowed them to move around in a different way. That's what's going to happen. It's happening as we speak with the devices that someone can carry in their hand. They're being connected in a global way, how they communicate, how they talk, how they play, how they work. This generation is growing up that way, and it obviously projects forward as we continue to move forward. The third big trend out there is our climate is changing. I think most folks probably know the stats by now. 15 of the last 16 years have been the hottest on record. 2016 is on pace to be the hottest. And what that means is that these folks growing up in this time period, a lot of us, are growing up through the prism of climate change, and that means we care enormously about sustainability. Millennials care about 20 points more about sustainability issues and climate change than baby boomers, and that manifests itself in terms of how they live their daily lives. You see shared bikes, shared gardens, shared tools, shared energy, which is called energy distribution. You even have shared pets in some places. But think about it from the perspective of home sharing. Right now, in the United States alone, there are over 13 million empty homes and over 33 million empty bedrooms. And for a generation that's growing up really trying to think about sustainable issues, how do you maximize utility and asset that is being underused? The fourth major change that's taking place out there is travel. This boat right here, this ship, is a ship that my grandparents took when they came from Naples, Italy to New York. It took them almost 2 weeks to get there. Today, you can make that same trip in about 9 hours over a plane. Really, since the end of World War II, you have seen the growth of travel and tourism. You take air travel, you know, as a proxy of tourism and expansion. Over 3 billion flights last year, air travelers. You look at international tourist arrivals, people who are traveling from one country to another. over a billion. And again, look at that line really since the end of World War II, an inexorable acceleration of that growth. Today, as you look at tourism, travel and tourism, it's almost 10% of the global GDP. That's enormous. Bigger than even big oil. And you have Chinese travel coming behind us, which is going to continue to accelerate that growth. And an issue that's really important here is that cities, states, countries are thinking about how travel and tourism fits into their overall economic plan because it's grown to this size. You're also seeing this dynamic where there's the haves and the have-nots. Some parts of communities are benefiting from this economic sector, some are not. I'll come back to that in a little bit. But speaking of the economy, that really gets to the fifth largest change that's taking place out there. And that is our economy is changing. We're going obviously from an industrial age where people work in plants to an information age where people are working in shared spaces. The mobility of the workforce. Over 60% of folks in this country have worked from outside of the office at one point or the other. The rise of independent workers, freelancers. Almost a third of all Americans are freelancers, have been a freelancer at one point or the other. Almost 40% of millennials, right? You can be an artist by day, a driver by night, and people like it. They like the money, they like the freedom, they like the work lifestyle, and it's one of the reasons why it's been so popular. But then, in 2008, there was a big disruption to what has been taking place. There was the Great Recession. We actually went back and spent some time with a prominent economist who had worked for President Obama and took a look at what the impact has been on the middle class. And in effect, in the United States, and this is really represented globally as well, the typical middle-class family has fallen behind by about $7,000 than where they would be otherwise. Obviously, we went through an election where people could talk about the dwindling middle class and economic inequality. You can see the empirical evidence of that right there. But as big of a disruption as the 2008 recession was, there's potentially an even bigger one on the horizon. And that is the rise of machines, the rise of artificial intelligence, the rise of robotics, and the fact that they threaten to displace an awful lot of human jobs. Some studies have suggested almost as much as 50% of all jobs could be replaced by machines. And you know, Jordan Friedman, prominent columnist for the New York Times, talked a couple weeks ago about the fact that we're not losing jobs to China or Mexico, people aren't losing jobs to other countries. What's going on is that people are losing jobs to microchips. I think all of us who are in the tech sector, in the tech space, this is something that's incredibly important. And I'll come back to this as we go along here in this conversation. But all these trends, all five of these trends came together. And with the catalyzing effect of the Great Recession in 2008, boom, they produced the sharing economy. The sharing economy really is sort of split or bifurcated into two sectors. One is shared labor, Uber driver or Lyft driver. The other is shared assets, shared capital. That's what home sharing is, using an asset trying to maximize its value, maximize its utility. And if there is an old divide word of where home sharing via a platform came from, it's on Rouse Street in San Francisco, where a couple of millennials got together and had a challenge trying to make their rent, came up with the idea of making their air beds available, made their rent, and you know the stories that goes from there. Taking a look at what happened. We went from an air bed to a bedroom, to a whole house, to a tree house, to an igloo, and over Halloween, if you wanted to, you could do a short-term rental of Vlad and Carol's house. Tom Dracula's house was available in Transylvania for a night. And look, the growth since 2008, it's been a blessing, it's been spectacular. But you can see what the visual, each of those links represent the network effect as the platform continues to grow and grow and grow. You know, today, over 140 million guest arrivals on the platform, bigger than the top three hotel chains put together. I think at times over the course of the year, we have had nights where there were 1.8 million people spending the night together, in a sense. 34,000 cities 191 countries. It's often easier for me to remember which countries were not in, places like Syria, Iran, North Korea. We're looking for our first volunteer to travel to North Korea, so let me know if there's any interest out there. And then you look at where the sharing economy is going over the next 10 years. Right now it's about a $15 billion a year business, but projected to grow to $335 billion over the next 10 years or so. And it's a really simple reason why this growth is taking place. People really, really, really like it. It's easy, right? It is affordable. It connects them with people. And it's very consistent with their sustainability beliefs and values. You know, over the course of the summer, during Republican and Democrat conventions, we actually did some polling. We wanted to see how people in America thought of the concept of home sharing. Lo and behold, over 70% support and believe that people have the right to make their house available, to home share their house. And then we took a look at folks who are familiar with the Airbnb platform, who either have been on it themselves, have family members on it, or had a level of familiarity with it. And over 80% of those people had a really favorable view. That explains an awful lot about the network effect. You know, today there's a lot of people doing home sharing, tomorrow there'll be more, and there'll be more the day after that. And again, that chart we saw earlier with all those lights really sort of explains how that works. Now, our base began with millennials. They were the initial folks who really got on this platform. But as we move forward, the constituency of the Airbnb citizen has really expanded. Today, amongst the 3 million hosts or homes that are hosted out there, our fastest growing host cohort are women over 60. That's a really cool thing of millennials traveling as guests and staying with women over 60. These senior women really enjoy it for two obvious reasons. One is it's helping them generate supplemental income. Some are able to avoid things like reverse mortgages, pay for needs, but also it's giving them a social connection with those empty bedrooms in their homes to be able to be connected to a larger world. And then the third constituency that has really developed out there is this middle-class urban constituency. Some of it are hosts, many of it are guests, but we're now getting to a size in communities that is really, really significant. Places like a San Francisco, a Paris, a Seattle, over 20% of the population in those cities are on the Airbnb platform. There is an Airbnb citizen out there, and we know, as the polling revealed earlier, that these are people who have an incredibly favorable impression of us. Now, to continue to be blessed with this type of growth, we do need to really deliver and continue to deliver on our core social value proposition. There are three elements that make that up. The first is democratizing travel. So in the 16th, 17th, 18th centuries, there was something called the Grand Tour, where if you were a graduate of Cambridge or Oxford in England, you would, in effect, get a personal tour of Europe after you graduated. You would see the art, experience the culture, experience the people, you have a private tour guide that would take you around. But that was really exclusively for basically the top 0.1%. You know, today, in large part, or no small part, because of Airbnb and everything that you do out there, you know, the ability for people to be able to travel has now opened up to the middle class, everyday people, in a way it had not been in the past. And then earlier I had talked about how the economics of travel and tourism are becoming a bigger and bigger part of the economic, overall economic strategies of cities and countries. Take a look and think about the effect that we are having on those cities who are looking at tourism as a central part or a major part of their economic strategy. So right, you can see with this visual, this is Washington, D.C. The green dots represent traditional conventional hotels. Not surprisingly, they're primarily clustered around where the mall is in the capital. And now let's look at the red dots. The red dots represent Airbnb hosts. You can see how it's spread out through the city. But let's zero in on a part of Washington called Southeast DC. Southeast DC has historically been a part of the city that really did not benefit from tourism. And you take a look at those green dots. There's about three green dots in there representing three hotels. Now let's look at how many red dots are there. Over 200 Airbnb hosts in Southeast DC bringing travel and tourism to a part of that city that just historically has not benefited from. And it's not just Washington, D.C. This is taking place in cities all across the world. Here's Paris. The green dots, again, clustered in more of a central area, the Marais, places that people traditionally would go from a tourist perspective. And now look at those red dots. Pretty phenomenal, about 65,000 of them in Paris, and they're spread out throughout the entire city, meaning that the entire city is benefiting from the tourism that's taking place that we, you, are responsible for. The second value proposition we need to deliver on is democratizing revenue. Earlier this year, I went to the U.S. Conference of Mayors. By the way, I apologize for scaring you with that photo. And I stood up and I said something that probably no private sector entity had ever said at the U.S. Conference of Mayors. U.S. Conference of Mayors is a group of roughly 250 mayors representing the big cities in the United States. And I said, read my lips. Our committee wants to pay its taxes. And since then, we've contributed over $100 million in taxes in the United States alone. If we're able to collect in the top 50 markets, top 50 cities, we would be able to contribute over $2 billion over 10 years. And it's really cool how some of this money is being spent. Now, here in Los Angeles, we did a tax agreement earlier this year, and the Airbnb community tax dollars being generated by those guests coming to visit Los Angeles and staying with hosts here is actually being used to help fund the city's affordable housing program. Which is a really cool way to spend money. Remember, these cities are all under significant financial stress. As more and more people move in, every single dollar counts. And so the dollars that we're generating, you know, is really having a significant impact in these cities. The third social value proposition that we need to deliver on is democratizing capitalism. What Airbnb does is unique. It's allowing, in the United States, a typical person, a typical host, a middle class person, using the house or home that they live in, they make 97% of the money off of that house. And a typical middle-class host in the United States is making about $7,500 a year, making their home available 47 nights over the course of that year. And remember earlier, we had looked at that chart about how far the middle class had fallen behind in the United States. And we looked at the revenue that the Airbnb platform, the Airbnb community is generating, and it's in effect making up for those lost dollars. So in terms of, I say this all the time, I go around and I meet with mayors and governors and prime ministers, presidents, and I always ask, I said, do you guys have a program out there that's generating this type of money for the middle class? The time when everyone's talking about how do we help the middle class? How do we actually address economic inequality? This is a great answer to that. Now, home sharing, I think everyone knows this, home sharing itself is not new. Home sharing over a digital platform is new. And anytime society goes through transitions, there's always going to be friction. You go back and look at something that was called the current wars in the 1880s and 1890s. It's when the electrical grid first was developed. The electrical grid is really one of the first technological-based networks that had been developed. And it's sort of interesting to think of what people said at the time. There was concern that light was going to impact neighborhoods. Governments wanted to apply the laws that were being used to deal with the gas light industry onto this new technology. Incumbent industries, the robber barons at the time, who controlled the gas light industry, were opposed to electricity. Sounds pretty familiar, doesn't it? And I think you can really see from this what we're going through, that there's three basic sort of points of friction that we need to address. The first is that new things just take some time for people to understand. Our society is going through a lot of big changes right now, and there's a lot of things that people have to get their heads around. Secondly, there is a tendency for governments to default to their existing old legal structure, even for new things, the proverbial square peg in a round hole. I mean, think about San Francisco, where we're based. They put in place a registration system. This is what the registration looks like in San Francisco to get a license. In some cases, it's taken people as many as 30 days to go through this process. Imagine the last year when the Super Bowl was out in San Francisco and someone's going to want to make their home available just for that week or just for that weekend. People just aren't going to spend 30 days going through a process like that. And then the third area of friction or point of friction is the hotel industry. This is an industry that had record profits and record growth, but obviously, you'll continue to see us as a challenge. Our perspective and view on this is that the whole economics of travel and tourism is expanding so much that there is more than enough to go around. So how do we accelerate the change that I fundamentally believe is ultimately going to take place no matter what? We want to accelerate the change. We have a three-step action plan. The first is to educate. Educate the public, educate elected officials. That sort of breaks down into three subsets. The first is to make information available. We've put out over 100 reports, studies, research papers over the last year. Second thing we do is we work with thought leaders. We have a mayor's council made up of some of the leading former mayors in the world. In fact, we're going to have Mayor Michael Nutter from Philadelphia, who is a great innovative thinker, who's going to be joining us after. I hope people can stay for that conversation. Third thing we do is we tell our story. We tell our story through paid media, earned media, digital media. We really rely on our host community to help them tell that story. The second action step that we do is based on the Airbnb public policy compact. This is something that we released last year at Paris. It's based on three basic principles that we're committed to. One is sharing and making information available in a transparent way so cities can see what our platform looks like. Second is paying our community, paying the travel and tourist taxes. And then the third is coming up with innovative, creative policies, the new laws for the new thing. And I think over the last year, we've had a lot of success on that. Considering some of the policies in a city like Chicago, remember that image I showed of the San Francisco registration process in Chicago? It's now just a quick pass-through. It doesn't take any time at all. You look at a country like France, which is looking to bring as many tourists back to France following some of the incidents of the last year. Our tax dollars are being used to help promote tourism in France. And then you come to a place like Philadelphia, which I referenced earlier. Philadelphia put in place a regulatory structure where if you're doing home sharing as an amateur or doing home sharing as a vacation rental, two different regulatory structures, but really designed to make the process as easy and straightforward as possible. And so we put this policy compact out last November, and over the last year, we have put in place more than 200 partnerships globally. Those are MOUs, regulatory relationships, tax deals. And what that really documents and demonstrates is that we as a platform, we as a community have the capacity to work with cities and put in smart progressive laws in place. Now the third action item in our plan, and by far and away the most important, is you, is this community. You guys are incredibly effective as advocates, as mobilizers. You going to talk as a constituent to your local representative, your councilman, your mayor, is just incredibly effective. And take a step back and think about it. Society has gone through any number of economic transitions. And typically, when they go through those transitions, people organize themselves. You go back to the 17th and 18th century, 19th century, craftsmen and artisans came together and created guilds. You got into the industrial age, and working men and women organized themselves into trade unions. And I fundamentally believe that as we enter this age, and this age of the sharing economy, that the clubs are the next iteration of people organizing themselves to represent themselves, advocate for themselves. So when I opened up, I talked about that we launched the whole club concept in Paris last year. We put out that concept. We had established a really ambitious goal of trying to create, and working with everyone here, to create 100 clubs globally. And I'm incredibly excited, proud, honored to be able to say that a couple of weeks ago I was in Berlin with Sebastian, who may be here, I'm not sure. There he is, over there. And we hit our 100th club in Berlin. And as I stand here today, we're now at number 109 and growing all across the world. I was in the reception last night with the club leaders, which really felt like it was an just enormous extended family. I met folks from Mexico City, from Tokyo, from Oklahoma. I even met the club from Buffalo, New York. I remember my Buffalo, New York home sharing club pin right now. But it was awesome to see. And I want to show you guys a video that we premiered last night about what the home sharing clubs are all about. And when I say this is really an extended family for all of us, I think this video really demonstrates and documents that. So let's watch this video. The film documented it began in San Francisco. I know we have a San Francisco crew here. Peter Kwan is where it all began, but it has really spread over the course of the year. I think of some of the clubs that I've encountered and spent time with. You go to Rio, which is chaired and run by Danielle and Leticia. I'm not sure if they're here, but there they are, back there, the Brazil crowd. And it's not Rio, it's not legal. They've a lot in the sustainability world, we've done toy drives, but have become just such an important member of the community. And then I think we have Meredith here from Tasmania, I think. But the Tasmanian Devils have been a real game changer. Sort of reversed the course of legislation there. I've worked with the small business community, have appeared in so many hearings. I'm going to be out in Australia in a couple weeks and look forward to getting down there. Rome, I think Emanuela's here. The Rome Home Sharing Club has been involved in street cleaning and really beautifying the great city of Rome. And then, of course, our home sharing clubs in New York. I mentioned Buffalo earlier. We have 9 clubs up and running in New York. Lee, I think Lee Thomas may be here. But Lee, unbelievable on our TBS, has a time all over the place. And really, each of these are just sort of symbols of everything that's going on in the world. But there's an African proverb, which is, you vote with your feet. Our community has voted in every single way in terms of your involvement in these activities. Take a look at some of the stats and data just from the U.S. alone in terms of what our community has done, and this is just in the last year. Over 300,000 emails to elected officials, regulators. These are coming from their constituents. Over our community, our entire community, over 14,000 meetings with elected officials and government officials. And then in terms of public hearings, we've had over 4,000 hosts participate in the public hearing process. And Teddy Roosevelt, the famous former U.S. president, talked about having the courage to put yourself into the arena, to put yourself into the political process. I'm just incredibly humbled by the fact that people in this room, people in our community, have had that type of courage to put themselves into the political process. I really do want to thank all of you for what you've been doing. Now, taking a step back, I really do believe the best is yet to come. A number of exciting things that we're moving forward on. The first is just last week, we launched AirbnbCitizen.com. That is our new digital platform for our community. It's a place where there is going to be content, explaining what home sharing is, educating, data, research, updates. It's a place for hosts in our broader community to engage one another. It's a digital platform to help with our advocacy of elected officials. To date, we've had about 100,000 members of our community engage on the platform. It's AirbnbCitizen.com. I would really encourage all of us to talk with our friends, fellow hosts, family members, and ask them to join and participate in this, because it's an incredibly effective tool for us. And speaking of tools, that gets to the next item that we're going to be doing. In about 2 weeks, we're going to be releasing something called the Airbnb Tool Check, Policy Tool Check. And this is going to be the complement to the Airbnb Policy Compact that we put out. The compact is based on principles. Tool Check actually has specific initiatives that we have put in place in different cities around the world over the last year. It's really built on 4 compartments. First of all, there is a tax compartment, the best tax policies that we've seen. The second is good neighbor, the rules to make sure that when our guests are traveling that they're conducting themselves in appropriate ways. The third is transparency, making sure cities have the information that they need to be able to effectively understand the platform. And the fourth is privacy, making sure we have the right protections in place to protect our community's privacy. Now, the big game changer, of course, is what was announced yesterday by Brian, which is Trips. Trips is just going to take this entire community in a fundamentally new and exciting direction. Obviously, it's an end-to-end travel platform. How are you going to get there? Where are you going to stay? What are you going to do when you get there? Who are you going to do it with? It'll be just incredibly exciting. But from the social value proposition perspective. What's incredibly interesting about this is that there is such an inherent value to the product itself, right? If you're a guest and you're traveling to Florence or Tuscany and you want to understand Tuscany, what better way to do it than with a local person who really knows stuff? You could go with a truffle hunter in Tuscany. If you want to go to Japan and really understand the history and culture, seeing it through the ideas of a Japanese sword artist and historian, great way to understand what's going on. And then think about going to Cape Town, Robben Island, obviously a place where Nelson Mandela was imprisoned. He was in prison for about 27 years. There's a trip that you can take with a person who was Nelson Mandela's prison worker and cook. And imagine being able to go see and experience South Africa and South African story through the eyes of someone who's actually at the prison with Nelson Mandela. Just to give you a sense of what that's going to look like, what that trip would be like, and to explain how this really works, there's a quick video of what this trip looks like. That would just be a transformative experience for anyone who's able to participate in that. Now, earlier we had talked about the democratizing travel. Trips, experiences, is going to contribute to our commitment to democratizing travel. We did a study that took a look at what the impact would be on local communities. And for every 100,000 trips that take place, it will generate about $25 million in economic activity going to people. About $13 million of that will go to the hosts who can set the prices. Another $9 million or so will be spread to the community, restaurants, shops, drivers, and other elements related to travel and tourism. But again, this will be the next step forward in terms of how we democratize travel. And then think about what it means for those hosts who are going to be participating as the experienced hosts. Some really cool experiences out there. A surfer here in LA, Malibu, a pottery maker artist, a haberdasher in Detroit, very cool city. Earlier we had talked about the challenge of the age of machines and robotics. This platform is going to be differentiated from a lot of other technology that's taking place out there, and that we're going to use technology to connect humans to humans. Humans will be able to enrich themselves, they will be able to empower themselves, they will be able to get additional economics for themselves because of the platform. And you think about that, you think about a robot can't surf, a machine can't make pottery, now, artificial intelligence is not going to be able to help you dress in the sharpest way possible. At the end of the day, you guys all know this because you do it every single day, but Airbnb is fundamentally about people and connecting people. Now, as we look to where we're going, I think it's really important to understand that every generation, every era goes through transitions and goes through changes. And when those changes and transitions happen, you have to look to put new laws in for the new thing, a new approach. And as you go through this, the status quo, the incumbents, almost always want to resist that. And history is pretty clear that you accelerate that process by people organizing amongst themselves and creating a movement. Our era is absolutely no different than what we've seen before. And because of all of you and what our community represents, I am as confident as ever in what I said last year at Paris. It holds true today as it did then, and even more so, which is to paraphrase the Victor Hugo line, there is no army of special interests that can stop this forward progress because the idea is so big. And ultimately, think about what's driving this idea. Go back to what I talked about at the very beginning, about some of the big trends that are taking place out there. You have this generation coming in, millennials, and the generation behind them. They're going to be, as I said, most of the voters out there. They're going to be the majority of consumers. And they absolutely love home sharing. You think about the planet we're going to be on. We'll be connected. Humans will be connected in a way that they never have been in human history. Our cities are transitioning into centers of sustainability, of which we are a great answer to and part of that answer. And then think about the shared economy. It's going to be a major part of the overall global economy. And our role in all of this, Airbnb's role, your role, our community's role, is really we are the platform that is connecting people. And that's why I think of us as a platform that's of the people, by the people, and for the people. Thank you so much for everything you do.
Time for purpose, for news to serve us, not with propaganda they use to hurt.